Hello, and welcome to Aviation Deep Dive. The Corsair is one of the most distinctive single-engined aircraft of the Second World War. An American-designed and built naval fighter bomber, its long nose and gull-wing profile make it immediately recognizable. But the design team, led by Rex Basil, used this layout not for aesthetic reasons, but because it was the easiest and most effective way of combining raw power with carrier-based practicality. The 18-cylinder Pratt & Whitney R2800 Double Wasp radial drove a massive 4-meter Hamilton Standard propeller that would have fouled the carrier deck in a conventional aircraft. But by giving the wing a downward kink precisely where the landing gear were, meant that both engine and propeller could be accommodated in an airframe whose undercarriage could be short and sturdy enough to survive deck landings. The double wasp and fuel tank were both placed forward of the pilot and accounted for a large part of its 10-meter length, giving it an excellent center of gravity and the nickname Hose Nose from its pilots. But this design also meant that the Corsair would be more difficult to fly and, more particularly, to land than its pilots would have liked. This is where the Royal Navy, or more precisely, the Fleet Air Arm, enters the story. The Fleet Air Arm was the unloved stepchild of British air power. It had only been handed over to the Royal Navy in May 1939, having previously been under control of the RAF, who had not had the resources or understanding to take very good care of it. The Legacy was a strange collection of mismatched aircraft designed to fight a very different war than the one that broke out in September that year. They had the Fairey Swordfish, a biplane torpedo bomber that would eventually deliver much more than its aging looks promised, but which was essentially obsolete. They had the Blackburn Skua, an unwieldy fighter bomber that fought valiantly despite slow speed and plodding handling, as well as its stablemate, the Blackburn Rock, essentially the same aircraft but with a turret replacing the very brave rear gunner with a single 303 gun. And a few months later, they had the Fairey Fulmar, a sort of more potent navalized fairy battle that also fought well but which was required to forget that its dad was a light bomber and to try and act like a fighter. The only truly dedicated fighter was the Sea Gladiator. Like the Swordfish, this was a biplane that owed its design more to the First World War than the Second, and although it would perform bravely over Malta later in the war, it was hopelessly outclassed. And that forms a postscript to all of these aircraft. Outdated and designed by well-intentioned people for the wrong conflict, they owed their success to some brave crews fighting overwhelming odds. But as the war continued and Britain found itself stretched between the North Sea, the Atlantic, the Mediterranean, the Indian Ocean, and the Pacific, it became clear to even the resource-strapped Fleet Air Arm that it needed slightly less doomed heroism and many, many more aircraft, particularly ones that were capable of meeting enemy fighters on much more equal terms. The most obvious way of solving the problem was to use a Spitfire and Hurricane, but neither aircraft was ideal. The Spitfire's narrow track, outwardly retracting undercarriage proved to be fatally unsuited to the impact of carrier landings and deck operations. The Hurricane was better, but it was a much less able fighter. Both of them lacked the range needed for naval operations, where distances could be huge, and where the minimum requirement for an effective fighter aircraft was one that could mount standing patrols which might last for hours. Part of the answer laid in an unfulfilled French order for Grumman Wildcats, which the British took over. They soon ordered more to fill the yawning gap in aircraft numbers. Pilots liked the Wildcat and praised it for its ruggedness and handling. Seeing as the American aircraft industry had already provided them with one very capable aircraft, the British hoped that the next generation of American fighters would be even better. When the Corsair was suggested, they took one look at its performance figures, particularly its range, and placed an order. The Fleet Air Arm pilots duly had their first look at the Corsair in the summer of 1943, when the pilots of four squadrons traveled to airfields in Brunswick in Maine and Quonset Point in Rhode Island in the eastern United States to begin flying them. They gradually progress through basic familiarization flights to dummy deck landings and then to actual deck landings on US carriers. But there were accidents, some of them fatal, just as the US Navy already knew that there would be. They had conducted deck trials back in 1942 and concluded that the Corsair handled in a way that made it inherently unsafe for carrier operations. Instead, they gave it to land-based US Marine Corps squadrons, who used it for the first time in combat at Guadalcanal in February 1943, but not before it had acquired the nickname of the Ensign Eliminator for its unforgiving handling. It was not accepted for service on American carriers until April 1944. The difficulty of operating an aircraft with such a long nose on a rolling and pitching carrier deck was obvious, but there were other, much less obvious problems. The Corsairs tended to float as they completed their approach, stubbornly refusing to land. When they were finally slammed onto the deck, they tended to bounce so hard that they cleared the arrestor wires meant to catch the aircraft's arrestor hook and crashed into the deck, or worse yet, flew over it completely and veered off the stern or the side while everyone watched in horror. There is even one story of a pilot being decapitated by an arrestor wire after a failed landing. And there was another, equally fatal flaw. As the airspeed bled off, the left wing of the Corsair could stall, losing lift and rolling the aircraft to the left. A rookie pilot who tried to get out of the stall by opening the throttle to increase power would find that the increased torque from the double wasp and its massive propeller would make this much, much worse and flip the aircraft onto its back with no room or time to recover. The Fleet Air Arm now had to address these problems, largely because they had no choice. Britain needed aircraft, the Corsair was available, and so the relationship would have to be made to work. Necessity meant that they made several changes. They introduced a variable rate bleed valve onto the oleo legs from the undercarriage, which stopped it bouncing. And they also introduced a wide, curving approach, first tried with the navalized Spitfire, that would lead the Corsair down onto the deck with a minimal risk of stalling, and which would keep the carrier deck visible until the last second. Other modifications also made other aspects of the pilot's life easier. British carriers had armored decks, which meant that there was less room in the hangars below the flight deck. 8 inches had to be clipped off the wings of the Corsair in order to accommodate them, which had the unintended benefit of improving its roll rate in combat and its sink rate on landing. The top flaps on the cowling were locked down to prevent oil from splattering on the aircraft's windscreen. The seat was raised in later versions, slightly improving visibility, and a more roomy canopy was introduced for the same reason, looking similar to the Malcolm hood fitted on RAF Mustangs. It meant that the early Mark I Corsairs looked very different from the ones that followed, with their restrictive greenhouse canopies and dull factory-applied camouflage. As the new modifications started being made, this initial batch of 95 Mark I's was superseded by 510 of the more advanced F4U-1s, delivered direct from Vought and designated as Corsair Mark II's in British service. Although 430 more would come from Brewster and be designated as F3A-1s, or Corsair Mark III's, poor quality control meant that none of them saw combat, and quite a few of these would lose their wings in flight due to weak wing fixings. Fortunately, 857 more came from Goodyear as the FG-1A, or Corsair IV, and it was only these, along with the Mark II, that would see action. As well as an updated camouflage scheme more suited to naval operations than life in New England, the Corsair II and IV would also need new roundels if they were going to operate in the Pacific as intended. The RAF roundels of the period had a large red center and a thin white circle separating it from the thick blue outer circle. Japanese aircraft also featured a large red circle, known as the Hinumaru, or meatball to Allied servicemen. And the British felt that the red disc at the center of their roundels might be mistaken for the Japanese markings. So, from September 1943, the red disc was painted over. US-style bars were added in March 1945 to further copy American insignia. but all these paint schemes lay in the future. Despite the fact that the aircraft that was destined to make its reputation in the Pacific, the British Corsair's first operational experience was with 1834 and 1836 squadrons in an attack on the German battleship Tirpitz in northern Norway. They flew as top cover for Fairey Barracuda aircraft in Operation Tungsten in April 1944, in an attack that left the Bismarck-class ship on fire and out of action when it was at anchor in Kajfurt. There were further attacks on the Tirpitz, with the Corsairs being used to suppress nearby flak batteries by strafing them. One of the pilots was a Canadian, Lieutenant Robert Hampton Gray, who made his name attacking through a particularly dense curtain of anti-aircraft fire and strafing nearby destroyers, and whose name crops up again in the Corsair story a year later. The Corsairs were in action again later the same month when they attached to Bodo Harbor and nearby merchant shipping, but it was in the Pacific where British and US Corsairs had their greatest success. They announced their arrival by joining a strengthened Eastern fleet formed around HMS Illustrious in Sri Lanka, helping to mount a strike on the island of Sabang in Sumatra, and then joining in with an attack on Port Blair in the Andaman Islands as both fighter escort and as a combat air patrol over the task force, where their extended range was a huge advantage. The Eastern Fleet were boosted by two more aircraft carriers along with the Corsair Mark IIs of 1834 and 1836 squadrons, and in July 1944 they attacked Sabang again, with two being selected to attack a radar and communications station on the island. They also recorded their first air-to-air victories, shooting down a Mitsubishi Ki-21 Sally bomber and an A6M-0 to the west of the island. The Japanese retaliated, and the Corsairs claimed around 5 enemy aircraft, with one of their pilots winning a Distinguished Service Cross for skilled flying. In mid-September, US forces landed on the Pacific island of Peleliu, with the Corsairs taking part in diversionary raids against Sumatran targets and attacking a railway yard at Sigli in northern Sumatra. They scored 7 more victories over Nakajima Ki-43 Oscars flying from the Nicobar Islands in October. In November 1944, the British Pacific Fleet was formed and 3 more carriers joined to give it even more weight. HMS Victorious had 1834 and 1836 squadrons, HMS Illustrious had 1830 and 1833 squadrons, and HMS Formidable had 1841 and 1842 squadrons, meaning that there were now 78 Corsairs available to the Royal Navy. They began strikes against Japanese oil production in Sumatra in January 1945, with the Corsairs attacking airfields to suppress the defenders' air activity, and Sub-Lieutenant Leslie Durno became the Fleet Air Arm's first Corsair ace, when he shot down a Ki-46 Diner and shared in the destruction of a Ki-21. More attacks against refineries came in Palembang on the northeastern coast, where they clashed with Nakajima Ki-44s that were led by Japanese ace, 1st Lieutenant Hideaki Inagama. But in a later strike against Soengi Gerong oil refinery, Durno was hit by fierce anti-aircraft fire, and although he managed to ditch his aircraft, he was never seen again. The fleet sailed for the invasion of Okinawa that started on April 1st, but found that a growing hazard was the committed kamikaze attacks against the Allied fleet. While one was shot down, along with the Zero, one got through the screen of fighter cover and slammed into the island on Indefatigable. Kamikaze attacks continued as the fleet progressed towards the Japanese home islands, with many Corsairs being wiped out in a strike on HMS Formidable and HMS Indomitable, and Lieutenant Don Shepard claimed his 5th kill to become another Corsair ace. By the time the fleet retired to Sydney, it had been at sea for 62 days, but it claimed 42 Japanese aircraft shot down. With Okinawa successfully taken, attacks started on the Japanese mainland. These were repeated strikes on shipping, on communication lines, and on airfields, but in reality, there were few Japanese aircraft that were able to get into the air. The last Corsair kill over Japan was a lonely, determined, and doomed Aichi B-7A Grace torpedo bomber that was shot down heading for the fleet. but one of the saddest incidents happened a few weeks before the end of the war on August 9th. Robert Hampton Gray had flown in the attack on the Tirpitz, also earned a Distinguished Service Cross for sinking a Japanese destroyer near Tokyo, and was tasked with continuing to harass shipping when he saw the destroyer Anasuka anchored in Onagawa Bay. Diving into attack, he sank the vessel with a bomb, but in the process, his Corsair was hit. Gray crashed into the bay and was killed. His bravery earned him a posthumous Victoria Cross. For the British Corsairs, the end came just as quickly. With the end of hostilities, the fleet sailed for Australia and the servicemen headed home. The squadrons were swiftly disbanded, and there remained the question of what to do with their aircraft. This is why this chapter of the Corsair story finally ends off the east coast of Australia in 1946. Under the terms of the Lend-Lease Agreement, Britain could either pay for the aircraft it had borrowed for the duration of hostilities, or send them back. America did not want them, and post-war Britain was broke, which meant that alternate arrangements had to be made. Aircraft that had served with the British Pacific Fleet and others that had been delivered but that were never flown were gathered together at bases and storage facilities in the east of Australia, waiting for the arrival of half a dozen aircraft carriers. These carriers then had the aircraft loaded onto their crowded flight decks and sailed to locations around the Sunshine Coast and Sydney Heads, where the Corsairs were unceremoniously dumped into the sea. Fire axes were used to make holes in some of the airframes and help them sink, but all ended their working lives in the same way. A Corsair cost $75,000 to build, and around 720 were dumped at sea, meaning that around $54 million worth of cutting-edge piston fighters were now slowly making their final journey to the bottom of the Coral Sea. An Australian company called the International Warbird Salvage tried to bring some airframes back to the surface in the early 90s, but the salt water had not been kind to them, and when they reached the surface, it turned out that they were too badly corroded to restore. However, there are still plenty of preserved Corsairs in existence, most in the US, but two of them are still in the UK, with one to be found at the Fighter Collection in Duxford. It was originally delivered to the US Navy as an FG-1D, and is currently painted as a British Mark IV. The other is also a Mark IV, and is resident at the Fleet Air Arm Museum in Yeovilton, having first been delivered to the Royal Navy in 1944. Another can be found in Robert Hampton's Grey's native Canada, and was painted to look like his aircraft, but had to be sold to a private buyer after a runway accident made it unflyable. Its combat career might only have lasted around 2 years, but the British Corsairs had a dramatic impact on the fleet air arm. Despite teething problems that asked difficult questions of pilots and engineers, it gave them a fighter whose endurance and combat performance were equal to their ambition. They deserved more than the watery and ignominious end many of them received, but their place in British aviation history is secure. A huge thanks to my patrons on screen now for supporting the channel, and thank you so much for watching this video of Aviation Deep Dive. Consider liking and subscribing for more weekly content, and please also consider supporting us on Patreon. See you in the skies.